Hi, my name is Amit Banerjee. I'm a group program manager with the SQL Server product group. My day job is to take care of the SQL Server database engine that runs your beloved SQL Server. So in today's episode, we will actually talk about how your container licensing that we talked about in the previous episode can be applied to SQL Server big data clusters that we introduced in SQL Server 2019. So you have a concept called big data cluster that actually allows you to join your relational database, that's your SQL Server instance. You can take any database and join it with any data that's sitting inside HDFS or any other external data source that is sitting outside of the big data cluster. There are a few scenarios that we enable with the SQL Server big data cluster in 2019. The first one is a data virtualization. The second one is a scenario where if your data needs to be cached inside SQL Server, you can create caches of data sitting inside your storage and your data pools, and you can create data marts on top of them. And the last one is you can actually run AI and ML experiments on top of it using things like Spark or Python or Java or R. These are all capabilities that we actually had in SQL Server 2017 and below. The Java one and the Spark are new. So let's see what a SQL Server architecture for a big data cluster looks like. So you have something called the Master, which is a SQL Server Enterprise Edition and Standard Edition instance. And then you have all the other components in it. So these are essentially a bunch of containers that are running either compute pools, so I'll call this compute pool, there's a data pool, and then there's a storage pool. So all of this is what we refer to as the cluster node. Now what the cluster node do for you is it allows you to actually expand horizontally. If you're running out of compute capacity, you can extend this horizontally, the data pools and the storage pools. Now, if you have a SQL Server 2019 or 2017 instance, which is not a big data cluster, you can actually take the database and you can, I'm going to use BDC as an abbreviation here, you can actually take the database and restore it into the master. So the BDC master can actually host a SQL Server database in there. And it is not just a 2019 database, you can host it from 2008, you can host it from 2012 or higher. A backup restore just works. The other piece that you could do is you can actually use data virtualization to read from it. So if you have external data sources like another RDBMS, or if you have a source like another HDFS source sitting in your enterprise environment, you can actually pull data from these and you can actually read from that. So this gives you a bunch of different business scenarios that you can enable with using SQL Server 2019 Big Data Cluster. Now the question comes in, how do you actually license for these? So let's say the master instance in my scenario is using an enterprise edition of SQL Server, and let's say that has about, let's say, 10 enterprise edition cores. And then your big data clusters, your big data cluster nodes have the compute pool, the data pool, and the storage pool. And let's say all of them have 10 cores each, just to keep the calculation simple. So now in this example, you have 30 cores of big data cluster in there. So you would need to license for 10 cores of enterprise edition and 30 cores of big data clusters in there. These are priced differently. Each big data cluster node is licensed by cores, and each big data cluster core is licensed at $200 per year. And what that does for you is it allows you to scale out your big data cluster environment or your master environment separately. Now, what happens when you do something like a data cache and you need to expand? So in this scenario, you can actually, for the first time, expand horizontally. So your big data cluster nodes could go from 10 to 20 to 30 to 40, and it could keep increasing as you need and as your needs for your enterprise actually grow. So in this scenario,
your 30 cores could become 40 without affecting the number of cores that are required in the master to run them. As long as you have compute capacity to run all of these scenarios, you should be able to license only for what's required for the master and what's required for the big data cluster cores inside the compute data and the storage pools. Now, the interesting piece comes in is what happens when you actually need more? Do you need to go buy? The simple answer is yes. But if you have, let's say, software assurance, which is a licensing benefit that you can enjoy with enterprise agreements with Microsoft, what that allows you to do is for each enterprise edition core, you actually get an entitlement of 8 big data cores. And if you have a standard edition core in the master, you get 1 big data core. So for each of these cores that you get, you can actually get more licenses or more entitlement to run this environment. So if I took this scenario here, and let's say I started with 10 cores in my master and 30 cores in my BDC, and I have software assurance, I am essentially not running this with any cost. This is actually an entitlement because these 10 cores now gives me 80 cores of big data for free. So till I actually exceed 80 cores, I don't need to actually license. So in a POC kind of a scenario, if I had to actually take this entire environment and draw what I drew below here, you would actually go from 10, 20, until you reach 80, there is actually no cost. You're running this for absolutely free, even in production. And then when you went to 80, 100, you would actually start needing to license 10 additional cores here and 20 additional cores here for big data at $200 per core per year. And the master continues to stay. Now, for example, if your databases started getting bigger and you had to move from 10 to, let's say, you now need to go to 20. Now, if I take that architecture here, now, if you had 20 EE cores, you would end up getting another 100 cores. So now you would actually get 80, and you would get 80 into 2. Previously, you were getting 80 into 80 cores because you had 10 in the master. Now you have another 80, so now that gets you 160 big data cores. So essentially, in this entire architecture, what ends up happening is if your workload increases for the big data, as long as you're not exceeding your entitlement and you have software assurance, you can keep increasing and you only pay the difference. If your master workload, if this workload keeps increasing, you would need to keep increasing your master. But what that does as a side benefit is it gives you more ability to scale horizontally for your big data in the future when you need to. So running POC is a lot easier. Moving that POC workload into production without incurring an additional cost for your environment becomes even more easier with SQL Server 2019 and Software Assurance. If you need to learn more about these capabilities, we have videos in this series earlier where we have talked about SQL Server 2019 and the capabilities and the architecture of the big data cluster. Thank you for joining this one.